Great. Welcome everybody to day two of the 2021 Planetary Health Annual Meeting, co-hosted by the University of Sao Paulo and the Planetary Health Alliance. My name is Max Zimberg. I'm the Community Building and Outreach Coordinator of the Planetary Health Alliance, also known as the PHA, based in Boston, Massachusetts in the US. I am very pleased to introduce the meeting's second round of Science Lightning Talks. On the theme of food and nutrition, which happens to be one of my personal passions and areas of what brought me to planetary health. Our global food system is one of the biggest drivers of environmental change and the impacts on human health, which also makes it one of our most important and powerful leverage points to enact deep structural change for human health, the health of the planet and all her biodiversity, as well as for equity, justice, and regeneration. I would like to briefly introduce our moderator, Aline, who I've had the pleasure of meeting at our last 2019 annual meeting in person, and then I will hand it to her to give the rest of the introductions of our panelists and to lead us through the session. Please note that during the pre-recorded lightning talk showcase, audience members, you are welcome to leave your own questions in using the Q&A function at the bottom of the chat, and we'll coordinate for Aline to be able to ask the panelists your questions live. So a little bit about Aline Martin de Caravajo. She is a nutritionist, a PhD in public health nutrition, and professor at the University of Sao Paulo School of Public Health. She's also the coordinator of Sustenaria, an extension project that promotes sustainable diets in Brazil. So welcome Aline and all our panelists, and over to you for the rest of the session.
Thank you very much, Max. And thank you all for being here. It's I'm very honored to be here and facilitate the food and nutrition session at the Planetary Annual Meeting. And I would like to thank the Planetary Health Alliance and the Planetary Study Group from the University of São Paulo, which are responsible for such a successful conference. And in this session today, we will have four researchers who will present their excellent work on food and nutrition. And we know food and nutrition is a very important field in planetary health because the way that we produce food and consume food impacts directly on the population and the planet health. And if we don't change the way that we produce food and consume that, we won't have planet to live and food to eat in 2050. So today we are here to discuss that, and we have four very interesting works. So the first one will be presented by Ana Claudia Dilda from the Hospital Conceição from Brazil, and then Canxi Chen from ETH Zurich, and then Rosemary Green from London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, and for the last, Simon Lloyd from Barcelona Institute of Global Health. So we now will watch the video from their presentations, and later we will have 20 to 25 minutes of discussion. So please, you can put the video, and later on we can discuss that. And please send your questions with the Q&A button.
Action plan submitted in the Brazilian Massive Online Open Ed course on planetary health. This work was submitted by Ana Claudia Dilda, Nayara Floss, and Ilana Rodrigues. The change in individual and collective behavior that contributes to the conservation of the Earth's natural systems is urgent. A recent study shows that climate change leading to extreme events influences human behavior to reduce the emission of greenhouse gases, which in turn reduce the impact on climate change. This model creates a rationale for expecting human behavior to affect the climate sufficiently to significantly reduce future global temperatures. Based on this, we analyzed within the activity proposed by the Brazilian Massive Online Open Ed course on planetary health, what behavioral changes people are more likely to make to impact planetary health. We made a qualitative analysis of optional action plans submitted in the first edition of the Brazilian Massive Online Open Ed course on planetary health, offered by Telesaúde. 241 plans were submitted, 231 signed the consent form, and two different researchers classified the plants through keywords. Summary analysis, by the title of the project, we found that 81, it means 35% of the participants' contributions were aimed at interventions that include the entire food system. We highlight the expressive number of action plans for healthy eating, with education in schools, changing menus in school and university cafeterias, changing habits in the family itself, building community gardens, and even introducing composting in domestic and work environments. It seems that food and nutrition interventions can be an acquainted and potent way for individuals and communities to transform the reality of the planetary health.
Hello everyone, I'm Canxi Chen, a PhD student from ETH Zurich, Switzerland. It's challenging for today's food system to feed the growing population with limited environmental resources. But at the same time, significant amounts of food products are wasted at consumption stage. Our study aims to address this issue and assess how much food waste reduction in each country can contribute to the nutritional and environmental sustainability. To do this, we first estimated the individual waste amounts of more than 200 food items in each country. We then assessed the nutritional losses embedded in the food waste, which considers the dietary, energy, and food and 24 essential nutrients. We then assess the environmental impact embedded in food waste using five indicators. They are greenhouse gas emission, land use, water use, nitrogen and phosphorus fertilizer application. Our study shows that global average food waste per capita per year contains 18 healthy diets. It also means that its embedded nutrients can fulfill the requirements of one person for 18 days. Cereals, fruits, and vegetables are the three major food groups that are contributing the most to the nutritional losses, followed by meat, dairy, and eggs that contribute substantially to the wasted calcium, choline, riboflavin, and zinc. From the environmental perspective, we also find the embedded environmental footprints accounts for 7 to 10% of daily per capita food-related planetary boundaries, and the highest in US, EU, China, East Asian, and the Pacific countries, and the lowest in Africa and South Asian countries. In short, all country-specific results identified global hotspots and picture the heterogeneity of the food wasting and associated impact. It highlights the different priorities across countries and across food groups, and calls for the effective food wasting reduction interventions. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Rosie Green. I'm from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, and I'm going to talk to you briefly today about fruit and vegetables and their relationships with health and the environment. So to introduce some of the issues relating to the UK in particular, which is where this research was done, we know that less than 30% of people in the UK are meeting their 5-a-day target for fruit and vegetable consumption. And we know that that has quite a large associated health burden. So diets low in fruit and veg are accounting for around 7% of the disability adjusted life years lost in the UK. And that's more than physical inactivity and alcohol use. The UK is also committed to being net zero by 2050, and that's going to have to mean some dietary change, including reduction in meat and dairy and eating more fruit and vegetables. However, in the UK, we import more than half of our fruit and vegetables. One third of that is coming from climate vulnerable countries, and half is coming from water scarce areas. So climate change might threaten our future supply of fruit and veg. So our main research question was, what would be the best way to 5-a-day from the point of view of both health and the environment? And we designed four pathways to look into this issue. All of the four pathways would increase consumption of fruit and veg to 5 portions a day, but they're based on different combinations and sources of fruit and vegetables. So 2 of the pathways emphasize vegetable consumption more than fruit, because vegetables tend to have a slightly healthier nutrient profile. And 2 of them emphasize UK production over the current global sources. So we wanted to see how those differences would affect health, the environment, and also the cost of the diets. And just to show you our results briefly, all of the 4 pathways increased life expectancy in the UK, some by more than others, and they all reduced greenhouse gas emissions. But the best pathway across the board tended to be the veg-same pathway, which was a pathway that encouraged more consumption of vegetables rather than fruit and vegetables, but included imported as well as UK-produced varieties. However, that wasn't the best pathway in terms of saving water. The Veg UK pathway on the top right actually used the least water per day. So there are some trade-offs there. And unfortunately, also, all of the pathways were more expensive than the current diet, which would indicate that we might need to consider some fruit and vegetable subsidies in order to make those diets accessible to the poorest people. So to summarize, prioritizing vegetable consumption over fruit would increase both health and reduce greenhouse gas emissions from the diet. It would contribute 30% to the UK's carbon reduction targets for agriculture, and also 10% of the target to increase life expectancy by 5 years. But there are these trade-offs. So if we want to be more resilient to climate change, we may want to consider using varieties that use less water, and therefore the UK might want to grow some more of its own vegetables. Thank you very much.
Simon Lloyd from IS Global, and our abstracts on climate change, hunger, and peasant farming. But let me contextualize this work in terms of 2 big themes in planetary health: transformation and complexity. Transformation, what is it? Well, this is a vexing question, but one way to think about the nature of the changes we make is to ask, are we, that's people and society, are we currently doing the right things, but we're just using the wrong stuff to do it? Or are we actually doing the wrong things and using the wrong stuff? So the former is about transformation based on improved efficiency and substitution of technology. The latter is about transformation that includes all this, but is also about changing socioeconomic relations. So our paper touches on these distinctions and their implications for health. For the first option, we look at futures based on entrepreneurial farming, which uses different stuff on the farm, but maintains and deepens existing socioeconomic relations. In particular, it's highly market dependent. For the second approach, we look at peasant-based futures, which in addition seek to change socioeconomic relations. That is, peasants seek to develop autonomy partly by avoiding market dependence and instead using markets as an outlet. So our paper takes a first look at the health implications of these different approaches, and the findings suggest that more full-blown transformation under peasant farming is more beneficial for both hunger and conditions that support rural health. Complexity. As we expand our horizons, as we're doing in planetary health, we're confronting issues of increasing complexity. In terms of models then, how do we address this? So one way is to add more and more stuff to existing approaches and seek greater and greater precision. In other words, tend towards supermodels. Second approach uses sets of strategic idealizations that view the same problem from multiple perspectives, each intentionally assuming away some aspects of a problem, and with each model adding new and complementary insights. Now, I think global level climate nutrition work has tended towards the first option. So that is, over time, progressively adding calories and hunger, then socioeconomics and stunting, then dietary diversity and chronic disease risk. And there's been some superb work. But all this work ultimately rests on a single perspective and has common underlying assumptions, some of which arguably matter a lot for health, one omission being stars of farming. So we adopt the second approach, strategic idealizations. And here we intentionally abstract away all sorts of detail and the model set in a hypothetical community. So it has many limitations, but it attempts to give us a clear view of processes that have previously been neglected, and that is the potential role of peasant farming. And it suggests that these omitted processes are important for hunger and health. So, transformation includes changing social relations. Dealing with complexity involves taking multiple perspectives. And together, these concepts potentially give more prominence to perspectives and desires of groups that may tend to be marginalized in health sciences, including peasant farming.
Okay, I think we have the four presentations here, and if the audience has some question, please put in the Q&A, and then we can talk here with the authors. So while we are waiting, I have some questions, and I can start with Ana Claudia. And I think it was such a great work that you did with and your co-authors with the Brazilian MOOC on planetary health. And I was wondering if you know the proposed plans were actually put in practice from the students, if you are thinking about that, if you are thinking to follow up with them to check if the plan were put on practice.
Hello, thank you, Eleni, for the question. This is a question we all had reading the action plans. We got very curious if they were actually putting it in practice. So this is a project that I want to do but for my work. My residence work, you know, to follow the people that completed the first course and see if they had put it in action, some of the plans and other things that we have proposed in the course. So my first idea was to work with the health professions, you know, but I'm not sure if in afterwards we're going to do other research and see if they're putting it in practice. So that's a question we still have for now. But we anxious to answer that.
Okay, thank you, Ana. We have some questions here. The first one is to Canxi, and is when looking at the food waste estimates, were you looking at pre-retail, post-retail, or both? And the amount of waste differs significantly along the chain based on the country and socioeconomic factors.
Mm-hmm. Yes. My estimates about the food waste focused on the food wasted at the consumption stage. So the losses during the rest of the food supply chain, like during harvesting, the agricultural practice, like the processing, distribution, transportation, is not included in our accounting. So we focus on the wasting from the retailers and the consumers, especially.
Great, and I have the same question in my head. And you are using like FAO data for estimate this waste, the food waste. Which data did you use for that?
Yes, for estimating the food waste for each country, we linked the edible food supply of each country and the waste percentage of each food groups. Yeah.
Thank you. We have another question from Carlos Guzman, and he asks, how would a reduction in importance of fruits and veggies from HIC, like England, impact the agriculture societies of the global south that depend on that export? How does this relate to the just transition, and is there talk in place to put safeguards for producers of the global south? I think it's more for Rosemary.
Yeah, that sounds like one for me. And it's a great question. I mean, I think the just transition is incredibly important. And when we talk about altering any trade patterns in terms of food, we have to think down the line to how this might impact producing countries as well. I mean, the first thing I would say is that the UK is a very, very long way away from producing all of its own fruit and vegetables. I don't think realistically that's going to happen anytime soon. It's, the the UK has not been self-sufficient for over 100 years, as far as I'm aware. So I think it would be very unlikely that the UK would stop importing from the countries that it currently does import fruit and vegetables from. But I think, given what we know about the vulnerability of fruit and vegetable production in some countries to climate change, particularly where rainfall is becoming less and less reliable, and there might be water shortages and water scarcity, and so the crops have to be heavily irrigated, I think it is certainly worth looking into whether we could grow more fruit and vegetables in the UK, which is a country where, as anyone who has been there will tell you, it rains quite a lot of the time.
Great, thank you. We have another question for you from Jess. Are you aware of, have you done the work of East Africa about the relationship between diets, health, and environment?
No, we haven't done any work in East Africa. We would absolutely love to. We're actually doing some work in West Africa at the moment, in the Gambia, looking at the relationship between climate change and food production and diets. But we are not doing any work in East Africa at the moment. But if you know of anybody who is, I would love to speak to them about it.
Great. And we have a question for all the researchers, and it's how do you see the role of communication to promote the changes we need in terms of incorporating the planetary health perspective into food and nutrition field of knowledge and change? It's a hard one. I think, Rosie, you can start, please.
Yeah, I'm very happy to start. So in terms of communication, there are some interesting things happening in the UK at the moment. I'll focus on the UK because that's where this work was done, although we do also do work in other countries as well. And I think the UK is sort of trying to get to grips with the idea that people might need to change their dietary behaviour, but possibly not as directly as we could. We recently had a climate assembly in the UK, and that was a really interesting experience. I was part of the scientific panel for it, and that was a real exercise in direct communication between citizens and government. And the message from the citizens came through very clearly that they do believe that the food system needs to change, and they're very supportive of farmers, and they would like to feel like they have more power in changing their diets. So I think often we have this view that people don't want to change their diets and they're very resistant to change, and that therefore the communication is very difficult. But I think it depends on how that question is approached. And that was one of the reasons why we took the approach of talking about eating more fruit and vegetables instead of eating less meat and potentially dairy, because those two things often go hand in hand, because unless you're going to eat more of everything, you're going to substitute the one for the other. And so as a more positive message, we've been talking about increasing fruit and vegetable consumption in terms of dietary change, and that seems to have gone over quite well.
Great, thank you. Canxi, do you want to add something?
Yes, I could add my personal opinion, because I didn't really do research on the interventions, but from my reading, it was reflected by literatures, maybe some review papers, that it would say communicating the nutritional and health benefits of the behavior changing, for example, reducing waste or consuming more fruit and vegetables. This kind of health messages is more important for an average person comparing to communicating the planetary health benefits, for example. So yes, I think if we can emphasize that, and it can be associated with also environmental friendly behavior change. Yeah.
Great, thank you. Anna Claudia, do you want to?
Yes, I think very interesting the Rosemary. What Rosemary talked about, because we know on the daily basis when we talk about changing eating, people get very how can I say it? It touches them, touches their heart. You know, when you talk about changing eating habits, And if you have a positive approach, it can be easily easier to do so. So instead of take this off, take that off, no, just get some more of this, get some more of that. I thought it's a great approach.
Great. Simon, do you want to add something?
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, this is a difficult question because I wonder, I mean, there's the form of communication. So I don't know what the best form is, but there's who's being communicated to, whether that's a general public or academia. Let me say, I mean, I think within academia, I mean, compared to the other three papers, I'm looking at the structural side. And I think that we need to have more work on the structural side. As I think Rebecca Solnit has pointed out, once you start looking at that, you're challenging power. And it's much more difficult than asking people to change their behavior. I think that's extremely important, the way people are consuming. But I think to actually have it having a really big effect, we need to be looking at the structure. And that's re-engineering the food system, if you like. Now, I'm not saying from above by re-engineering, that may happen from below. But that's the big part of communication, I think, that we need to be looking at structure as well. And it's difficult because of your challenging power.
Great, thank you. I would like to add that we have here in São Paulo a project called Sustentaria. That is an extension project. So we have undergrad, grad students, and they work to communicate with population about sustainable diets and how to change. So we use two forms. We use information, and then people can know about how to do that. And we also try to do some support. So we teach how to make some different recipes and make real change in their lives. And it's a very small project, it's not so big, but we think we can try using our knowledge from the university also to communicate and talk and see what is the big problems with the society regarding sustainable diets and how we can help them and they can help us to work together and go to a more fair and society and have a more sustainable food system. And we have more questions here for Simon. Thank you for your very intriguing presentation. Could you perhaps elaborate on why and how patterns of farming style matter when attempting to understand how climate change may impact on future nutrition and health?
Yeah, I'll be very brief because I could go on for a long time about this. A good place to have a look is the poster because I've kind of mapped out what the work is trying to do. Most of the pre-existing climate nutrition work at the global level kind of traced a path from food production to nutrition. So really what it was saying is if we have less food of lower quality, we'll have more hunger and we will. And this is a very important perspective. But what that really looks at is individual biology and physiology. If an individual doesn't eat enough food, they're going to be undernourished or whatever. But what we're interested in population health, of course, is what's shaping the distribution of hunger or undernutrition. In other words, which groups become at risk. And that's what this is trying to get at, this piece of work. So what it's looking at is how farm development trajectories may shape the distribution of hunger. And what the work shows is that you have a constellation of farmers practicing different styles, and then they're going through a development trajectory through internal relations, through processes of industrialization, through processes of peasantization, re-peasantization or de-peasantization, through processes of deactivation of land, that changes the constellation of farmers and so on. Now, parts of that process are then shaping hunger. One of them, the obvious one, is how much food is produced. A second one though is how many farms are able to convert from subsistence farming to a more sustainable for themselves livelihood and also producing food. So people who can convert to a preferred style of farming. Then you also have people who have blocked development. They can subsist, but they don't have the resources to develop. So they're living a very precarious lifestyle where probably their hunger they're hungry because they're not getting enough food. And then you have people who have to leave farming because they're starving. And so these three aspects of the farm development trajectory are shaping nutrition. But as I say, I would have a look at the poster. If you want to read the paper, you can. It's very long, though. Let me say as well, let me add to this, because it's not only about hunger. What this work is trying to get at is that the same processes that are shaping hunger are also shaping conditions that support health in rural populations, shaping patterns of income, patterns of inequality, whether people have work, and environmental use of the land. Conventional work has usually put all this kind of stuff in as exogenously specified scenarios. But here we're kind of showing that the same processes shaping nutrition are shaping viability of vibrant rural communities, let's say. So yeah, but please, I mean, do have a look at the poster I'll stop there.
Great, thank you. We have another question here. Is only a plant-based approach is enough? I say that because it's a trend among people. That's why we can see worries about the origin of food, animal or vegetable, but no concerns about the origin, organic, local, ethical, how to be more holistic when it comes to planetary health impacts of our food choices. I don't know who wants to answer that. Anna, Rosie.
I can start, maybe, if you want to follow on, Anna. Yes, I mean, this is very much chiming with the sort of less and better idea that has been floated with regards to sort of meat and dairy consumption, that not only should people in high income countries be eating less meat and dairy, but it should be from better sources. And then that goes alongside improvements in animal welfare, improvements in, you know, land use and the way that the soil is treated. And I think all of those things are really important as well. We cannot just talk about the types of food we're eating. We have to talk about how they're produced. That involves having a conversation about industrialized agriculture and to what level we should be continuing to do that. So yes, I think all of those things have to come into the conversation. And the sort of less and better concept is one that we talk about quite a lot in the UK, that if you do reduce your meat and dairy consumption, that allows you to pay more of a premium for the meat and dairy that you do consume, and to make sure that it's coming from higher quality sources and to protect those other elements of the food system.
Great. Anna, Simon, Canxi, do you want to add something?
Oh, yes, no doubt. We have to take the whole footprint beyond the whole way the foods walk, you know, how it's produced, where it's produced, how it's transported. So always it's important to get from food from local producers as possible. And it's better if you think to reduce meat and dairy, then cut it, and in the place of milk and dairy, you have vegan industrialized food, you know. So it's not the best choice for sure.
Great. And we have a comment to Simon saying that I love the Simon presentations. I do class on this topic, systemic and complex thinking and One Health. Thank you so much for this wonderful symposium. So it's very nice. And there's another question. I would definitely love to speak to you on these. I have the will and some few plots of land, but honestly don't have the technical know-how. Yeah. Sometimes we don't know how to put in practice. It's a lot of stuff, and our own field is not enough to put everything in practice, but it's cool. And I have a question for Simon that I was wondering when you, in your paper, you put the climate change and the public policies in the models. How did you do that? You put in levels, like a flexible public policy, a more restrict one. How did you do that?
Yeah, It was intentionally done quite simply, actually. In terms of climate, there's an origin for the way I handle climate is that I've worked on a number of climate health projects, and my experience, not wrongly, a lot of attention was given to the climate side. Much less attention is given to the social side. I think that's a problem. And that's why what I've tried to do here is pay a lot of attention to the social side, if you like, and then look at how the social system's operating, and then ask, well, how might climate impact on that? Instead of kind of following this pathway from climate into society, onto health impacts, and saying, well, society's just a modifier. It's more than just a modifier. So I represented by intent climate quite simply. What we did is assume for high climate change, a linear warming trend over 50 years of 2 degrees Celsius. And for low climate change, a linear trend of 1 degree warming over 50 years. And we also accounted for drought as well. There was an increasing probability of drought in the model, depending on the climate scenario. So very simply, and so it's totally transparent, it was the intention. In terms of policy, again, quite simply, for entrepreneurial futures, so very focused on purchase inputs and export agriculture, we just had lower interest rates, so that people would use credit. And we had subsidies for fertilizer. Fertilizer stood in for all the things that people buy, it's sort of for herbicides, pesticides, whatever. So that was what entrepreneurial scenario was like. Peasant scenario was meant to be giving support to peasant agriculture, which is very neglected in research. And that's something that needs to change as well. I mean, and agroecology, for instance. And so it was assumed there was more support for that research and more support for community networking. And that was represented in the model simply by an increase in the rate of productivity increase over time for peasant farming. Incidentally, we also had an entrepreneurial eroding scenario where we started with the entrepreneurial policy and then said, over time, what if this support for entrepreneurial farming goes away? What if credit isn't cheap anymore? What if inputs are no longer subsidized? And this is a real possible scenario because entrepreneurial farmers depended on external conditions. And then we found there was trouble in terms of production because we put all our, we said, well, let's go with this export agriculture model, but it's contingent on external conditions, not just the farm. So anyway, that's how we did it. And let me stop because I know we're running out of time.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much for your explanation. And we are almost over time. So thank you very much for all for being here. And we have some questions that we couldn't answer here, but you all can go to the website and go to the chat and talk to the speakers here and also to other researchers and from the conference. So I would like to thank you all for being here and to talk about this important field in food and nutrition and planetary health. And I hope I see you all through the conference and in other spaces and next conference on planetary health too. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.